I want to talk about is the C++ coding standard that's used for JSF and other safety critical systems at Lockheed and other places now. And when I was asked to give the talk, I was thinking, what coding standard talk in front of, you know, such a brilliant field? And Herb Sutter, you know, Alexander Alexandrescu, they just, well, a few years ago now, released such a great coding standard. What do we need another coding standard talk for? And so co-workers and I got around over lunch and realized after a lunch that went on for over 2 hours, we realized that there really was enough to talk about for to hopefully fill an hour. Not so much about a general coding standard, but what is it about the JSF coding standard or safety critical systems in general that are unique and hopefully give a little bit of insight into what is special or different about our application in the embedded world as opposed to general purpose or large scale computing. As just a quick overview, I'm going to talk briefly about the background and philosophy behind the JSF coding standard. The coding issues that are distinct to our application. Looks like I have some. Automated testing of the standard. Anything that we can do to get compliance and as a safer product as possible automatically checked is the better. That saves me a lot of hours in code review. Not that code review is something we take lightly, but everything we can do to get problem solved before the code review starts is a good thing. And lessons learned. The coding standard itself has been, in some form or fashion, kind of had a genesis going all the way back to the late 90s, when Lockheed Martin selected C++ as the programming language to be used for the Joint Strike Fighter development. At the time, most of our work at Lockheed, and as well as our partners, was in Ada, and so needless to say, that kind of raised a few hackles as to why we'd abandon Ada in favor of C++. In particular, how can we make C++, which was seen at the time as being just an intrinsically expert-friendly language, not that it's even sometimes more so now, you know, to make it codified in a way that can capture the benefits of the C++ language, but doing so that can be in a, you know, safe environment. But the rules were that the Ada tool chains that we had and were looking at were in decline. The C++ tools at the time were improving. Compatibility among the compilers was improving. And frankly, we were hiring a bunch of people, and a lot of them knew C, and or at least said that they knew C++. I thought I knew C++ until I really got into it after several years. And just the last day, I've learned more than I thought I didn't know. So, a few years later, no less than Bjarne Strofstrup actually came to Lockheed to assist in the development of the coding guidelines, which here we're calling JSF++ because the full name of the coding standard is too long to say. Revolves around air vehicle system, coding standard. At the time, there were other sources of C and C++ programming guidelines available, but no single coherent set really captured everything that we wanted to say. One thing that was available at the time was MISRA C 1998. And if you look at the coding standard, you'll see that we've inherited a lot of MISRA C 1998 into the coding standard, almost verbatim in credit. But of course, as it's MISRA C, it's limited to C constructs. What that means, of course, is that, that by itself wouldn't be sufficient to our needs because we wanted to use C++, which gives us stronger type checking, can eliminate the need for macros because we can use templates in a type safe ways. We can use container classes as very efficient, you know, but type safe containers. In C, we typically had to go either roll our own to make type safe, but every type had its own container, or genericize and then lose type safety by going through void pointer cast everywhere. And finally, you know, we could eliminate C pointers in most all the application code in favor of smart pointers. There's also something called embedded C++, which was really a strict subset of C++ that was advertised for embedded application. But we really felt that that was overly restrictive. It, you know, didn't include namespaces, templates, or multiple inheritance, and all three of those we thought were really essential for what we wanted to do on a project as large as the Joint Strike Fighter. But in terms of what we are looking at, in terms of, you know, what steered the standard and how we write the code that we do, one is the idea of hard real time. A lot of application development in the large is about amortized, you know, runtime speed. How fast is it on average? In our environment, I really don't care how fast it is on average. What I want to know is what is the worst case time, and so if the average time for an operation is a millisecond, but there's one operation, you know, outlier that could take a second to garbage collect, well, that's obviously not going to work for us. The other thing about that, or the design, is when you're talking about something like flight control systems, you know, weapon release, you know, we treat scheduling failure as a fatal error, and this you can read fatal error a couple different ways. So I have to kind of be careful when I'm talking in front of the pilot audience when I use the term crash and fatal error, because they get excited. And I've been in crash review boards. You don't want to be there. And the last thing you want is you don't want software to be the reason. You don't want crashes, but you don't want software to be the reason. The other thing is we've actually got fairly decent processes, but memory's limited. There is no way to page something off, you know. So a memory leak is just out of the question. We have to guarantee, you know, that regardless of how long the airplane is flying or operational, that memory leaks just aren't going to happen. Memory is limited to what's physically on the card. And I already mentioned this, and it should be fairly evident that here we're talking about flight safety, that, you know, it, meaning, you know, potential loss to the aircraft if something fails. Jet fighter is probably more sensitive even than, you know, other aircraft, because you're doing, well, I've seen these pilots fly. I mean, they're flying low and fast, so ground collision avoidance system failure at the wrong time is not a good scene. But even when we have systems to fail safely, we don't want to have a mission abort. So it's almost as important to be flight safe as to be correct in all cases. So we can include mission critical applications as in systems that aren't safety critical, but they're really essential. You know, we don't want to, you know, spend the taxpayers' dollars, pilots' time, you know, if we're flying around and not being able to do the job. Nobody wants to hear return to base. And finally, system, the way the system is architected. We actually have the system is embedded software, but it's really running in several different operating systems in different environments besides the airplane itself. We test the system in simulators, which oftentimes are running in Linux. We have sensors code running in simulated in Visual Studio. We have probably, you know, five compilers that I'm currently supporting. So the code that we write has to be pretty much a subset of all the different compilers that we use. And maintainability. Before I came on board F-35, I was working F-16, and that plane, you know, was a fly-by-wire plane, came out in the mid-70s. We're still selling F-16s, and it's, you know, four decades later. So there would be pieces of this code we plan to support in some form or fashion, literally for decades. So I'm planning on possibly retiring on this program. So we're looking at the C++, you know, at large, you know, what can we do to make it as safe as possible, but at the same time as productive as possible? And so what we also wanted a common style. You know, when I first started, you know, talking about coding standards, and I wrote a coding standard for F16 usage before I came on C++, you know, I often looked at coding standards as, boy, this is telling me all the things I can't do, and I loved C because I could do anything. But really, I find that the coding style guidelines are really liberating because I can eliminate arguments about the one right religiously correct brace style and really key on the important things, you know, making the code do its job. And also, you know, we wanted to identify, you know, in one place, potential undefined, unspecified, implementation behind behavior, all the things that the people in, you know, software quality shudder when they hear those words. And so everything we do, and again, because it's also running in multiple environments, we want it, if it's running in the trainer system for the pilot or in a simulator for, you know, radar electronic warfare evaluation, if it's running on the plane, we want the same software to run the same way. And also, I've mentioned this before, is the coding guideline is not just what not to do, but also what to do instead. And most of the support there is in the form of library components. And I already mentioned this before, but everything we can do to get the guidelines automatically verified is a good thing. Code that's, you know, to everything that we can check statically, it saves us time over dynamic error detection. I mean, the beauty of static analysis is that, unlike me, I get bored, I get distracted with emails and pages. The static analyzer never misses a line of code. I may argue with it, but it's not going to miss a line. The things I'm going to talk about more specifically about the coding standard is resource management issues, use of arrays, multiple inheritance briefly, fault handling without exceptions. One of the things that JSF++ took out of the language is exception handling. I like exception handling, but it has its own issues that, you know, to be safe and, again, predictable and understandable. You know, a couple other reasons about tool support at the time. Exception handling is not allowed in the JSF code currently. For similar reasons, JSF doesn't allow use of RTTI. We'll talk about that briefly. Use of templates in this standard. And a similar comparison of JSF++ to MISRA C++, which really built on JSF++ in this. In terms of resources, you know, I already mentioned memory's fixed. There's no, you know, avenue to allow a leak. So the way that's done in JSF is basically just a hard and fast rule. The free store is just not to be used except during initialization. It guarantees that we won't have to worry about fragmentation because where we do have storage is coming from fixed size pools. So also means that when it's implemented correctly, grabbing an object, you know, from localized pools is a completely constant time operation. And in conjunction with the development of the standard, we created a library that provides STL style class specific allocators, you know, to accomplish this. And where this comes into play is, for example, in use of vectors. The STL allows, you know, user customized allocators as an option. For JSF, our library pretty much requires use of a custom allocator. But again, the library provides a good set of default allocators that will get the job done as long as you know a priori how big your worst case sizes of objects are going to be, which does make things a little bit more challenging than they would be in a general application environment. The other thing about using a custom allocator is we can decide whether or not this object is going to be maintained by a single thread or multiple threads. We know that we can guarantee that these objects are only living in one thread, we can use an allocator that doesn't need a mutex around it. So there can be performance issues there that we can gain. But simply using, a library that provides, constant time allocation, that doesn't solve all of our memory allocation or memory management issues. C pointers and raw resource handles, lead to a host of potential problems. I think this audience probably knows them well. Raw pointer, if you use it wrong, you can get a leak, you can have a dangling pointer, and you can have issues of, resource ownership. When I have a pointer in the interface, do I know whether I'm supposed to manage the pointer when I get that pointer or where it came from? So really, every time I come across code to review, the first thing I look for is use of naked pointers. I found very few places in high-level application code where we really, really need them. I really emphasize resource acquisition is initialization paradigm. I mean, we pretty much eliminate the cases of the classical leaks, not entirely. There's still ways of screwing things up. You can't directly call delete on a thing, so it really requires people to think a little bit more on the management and using something like a shared pointer or unique pointer. I mean, ownership is pretty much understood, or at least it's automatically maintained. The other thing that gives us is, there's probably a half dozen rules in the coding standard about, have to write a copy constructor if you got a pointer, have to write an assignment operator, what to do about destructors, But really, if people just use the shared pointer or unique pointer, basically, the compiler-generated, assignment operator, copy constructor, they're going to do the right thing. I've seen more errors than I can count going through code reviews of developers thinking, it's C++, I have to write a copy constructor for this, or have to write an assignment operator, and then through code maintenance, they forget that the list of attributes in the class no longer matches what they have. Yeah?
So you mentioned unique pointers. The code extension, you said dated back to sometime in the 90s?
That's correct.
What did you do for the rest of the
unique pointers? Well, we have our own libraries that we maintain. So there's a lot of what we have is we don't really use the STL as such. So yeah, what we're actually using is C++ 98, but we have our own container libraries.
So I guess more precisely, what do you do
with our value references? We're currently using C++ 98. So our value references per se, we don't have that semantics supported, if that answers.
Well,
I'm
so
not sure.
I mean, that's if you're in C++ 98, there's no concept of remove only type. So are you basically using something like auto pointer, which transfers ownership on copy?
Well, I'm talking about use of a scoped pointer, basically.
Uh-huh.
Most of what we do is with, in our application, shared pointer is the vast majority of what we use. And the other thing I just add is that RAI is not limited to pointers. That's what most people coming into it think. But mutexes have the same issues, and C++ 11 provides lockguard. We have our own RAI classes for mutexes. It solves similar problems that the shared pointer does for memory. Arrays are a long-standing problem in C, and one of the things I like about C++ is the compatibility. One of the things I don't like about C++ is it pulls in all the things that I didn't, that can be problematic in C. in C. And pointer to K is in fact the big thing. I mean, here's a pointer, a function that takes a pointer. Is it a pointer to a single object? Is it a pointer to an array? We really don't know. Well, I can write it like this. Well, no, that's really the same thing. It's still a pointer to, the compiler is still going to treat those two the same. So what we do is we have a template library that encapsulates arrays as a concept, and it's really a like vector, although it allows like a regular array a compile time defined size of the array. So you get really almost zero overhead, but you get the type safety. The containers knows their size. You don't have any implicit conversions, to a pointer that you don't want. And just as an aside, we have legacy code, we have interfaces that define things in arrays. What I like to do is I like to, keep those on the interfaces on the margins and use a wrapper that encapsulates a reference to an array and make an array reference or array vector, container out of it.
Can I ask one question?
Sure, of course.
Since it's a slide back, I wanted to get a break.
Of course.
You said you don't use exceptions for error status.
That's correct.
And you said you use RAI for mutexes.
Yes.
So how do you reconcile that? In other words, the mutex, if you can't acquire the mutex, what do you do? Do you acquire it separately and then install it in a guard? I'm just curious. We have this problem.
You say, if I can't get the mutex?
Wait, what I understood you to say is you don't use this just for memory and pointers, you use it for other resources like a mutex.
Absolutely.
So do you have a mutex class that you construct, and then if it can't get the mutex, what do you do?
Well, we always, I mean, within a time bounds or we can't get it at all. If there's a deadlock, the system watchdog fires and
okay,
it's a fatal error.
What you're saying is that happens so infrequently, like almost never, but it does return status, right? So
yep.
If it were to fail, rather than throw an exception, you kill the entire system.
We kill it.
We do the same. Excellent.
Yeah, because again, going back to the first thing, I mean, there's applications where our system is, I mean, we're not loading from disk, so we can restart in a couple seconds, It's better for us to do that, than to try to, recover from some fail stuff. And it really is a catch-all thing. I mean, it's just really expand on this. Our philosophy has been. Guard ourselves on the interfaces. I personally don't trust my inputs to the box, but past then, if I'm in a state where, this isn't right. That's an assertion. I can't trust anything more. There is no reasonable recovery in many cases.
Well, I totally agree with you. See, the thing is, what you're saying is we can't even use dynamic memory because it could really fail. But not being able to get a mutex while the interface says that's possible, you and I both know that's not going to happen in any normal world. If it does happen, let's kill it.
Right.
Perfect.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, we do spend some in analysis to try to keep our guard ourselves against deadlocks. And I could go on a side talking about real time operating system development. That's beyond what I can do in an hour, though.
Sure.
Oops, technical problem here on the button. Now, one thing that we departed from the embedded C++, that it was, the specification called embedded C++ at the time was multiple inheritance. At the time, MI was, somewhat controversial, And personally, I think we all know that, when in doubt, use composition. But multiple inheritance was deemed to be just too important to just throw away. But what we did is we specified rules on when to allow it and when it's appropriate. And in short, the definition in the JSF++, I wasn't there at the time, but you're reading it, I'm thinking it must have been a lot of conversations because it's a fairly long definition, but it really comes down to use it for public and interface inheritance, or use it for private implementation inheritance, but not both, you know, or not unlimited public implementation inheritance. And specifically, you know, mentioned in the JSF++ is reference to Andre Alexandrescu's use of policy-based design, you know, especially in terms of composing objects with templates. But within the purposes of the JSF rule, an interface may contain, you know, non-virtual protected methods and small data items also. So we are a little bit flexible in what the definition of interface inheritance is. And to me, that's a good thing, you know, because I first started, you know, thinking, you know, like Java, that, you know, of what an interface is. And then with Herb Sutter talking about non-virtual interface, that was really a concept that I really, really took to. Yeah, you bet.
In practice, do you see a lot of multiple inheritance in your code base? And are you happy with the results?
I do see a lot of MI. And am I happy with the results? It depends. I find it's inheritance is just so easy to use. You know, I think a lot of developers, including myself, fall back to that as a first way to reuse code. But then downstream, you know, oftentimes find myself refactoring it into a compositional thing. So I haven't had an issue, you know, from a matter of program correctness as much as maintainability.
If I rephrase the question slightly, if you could wave a magic wand and go back in time, would you keep those rules?
I think I would.
You're going back this year.
Okay. I mentioned exceptions aren't allowed in the JSF standard. At the time JSF++ was defined, actually, the compiler support of exceptions, or the implementations, really, as much as anything, varied quite a bit widely. Some paid a cost, whether exceptions were thrown or not. Others paid the cost when exceptions were thrown. And the overhead, we didn't really have the tools even to predict reliably how much overhead there would be with an exception. And so just as a simplifying factor, and to make sure that we could get the JSF coding off the ground, we basically disallowed exceptions. And that eliminated issues of worries downstream in terms of knowing and ensuring that whether all exceptions are going to be caught, is the code exception safe, control path issues. So we just simply eliminated exceptions, but we didn't, that doesn't solve our, you know, that. That's no panacea, because C++ exceptions are there for a reason. I like them. So that doesn't eliminate the need for fault handling. So primarily, error conditions are handled by functions that return an error. You know, for an automated tool, it's a little bit hard to check, because, you know, what is error information? You know, is it, you know, some functions return a status that we can safely avoid or ignore, and other functions that return statuses. It's really treated as a status error. But for our purposes, you know, in our automated tools, basically we assume that if a function's returning a value, it needs to be used or cast to void to explicitly, you know, advertise that this is something we've already considered, and it's not an error case that needs to be handled. So that's fine for plain old. Yeah.
Do you just rely on code reviews to make sure people aren't overusing cast to void?
On cast to void?
Yes.
Well, actually,
tools can't tell if you can cast to void the tool being okay enough to deliver a position, but it's very easy for people to casually go, "Oh, I don't need to check this, it's debugged."
Well, for casting to void, I'm not so worried about it. It's casting from void that I'm worried about. You talk about typecasting.
What you're saying is people get in the habit of casting everything to void. They don't care.
Oh, the function return type, yeah. No, there's, we rely on coding review, yeah. Yeah. Not currently. So, you know, functions that can return an error code are great, but constructors don't return an error. Overload operators don't return an error code, and some functions just, for whatever reason, don't. One thing we can do is we can move potentially failing constructor code to separate initialization or factory methods. And there you've got a clean interface to provide that. And that also kind of works. I've found over the years that keeping constructors simple really is a good thing.
I have to ask another question.
You bet, yeah.
Is there a notion of having an object that's invalid as a result?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we do have that concept. It's not something I relish, but we do have the concept.
Okay, so the alternative to that, which I agree with, is you gather your resources and then you create your object, whether it be a factory or something else.
Right.
So you're not using RAII per se, you're using the other end of it, which is resource destruction is deletion or something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
Resource deallocation is
But here's a case where we have an alternative of what you said is an invalid object. Basically, if we have a matrix class, and if for whatever reason the operation fails, you know, we had overflow, we had whatever, or one of the input parameters itself was marked as bad, we actually have the object have a, what we call it in our libraries, a bad flag, but essentially it's to mark it as such. And that's carried through successive operations and chained operations. The one problem with this, of course, and this is, again, maybe an argument for formal exception handling, is that it requires a user to know about this and to use it and to implement code that it is fully knowledgeable of the fact that this object may be in a ill-formed state for whatever reason.
Yeah. Sorry to keep saying this, but this is really cool stuff. If you do this, then you run into the problem that everybody who takes the matrix has to ask themselves, should I check to see if it's valid?
Yeah.
And that is really insidious when you talk about something like a date. So in our world, you just simply can't have an invalid date, which is not possible.
Yeah. Well, I think application-wise, you have to look and see where it's appropriate and not appropriate to check. So, but
we have your same mindset, by the way. We're infrastructure.
Just going about the bad state object is one thing is this, compilers and lint type tools who complain about unused return values. Obviously, they can't complain about this. So, yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Use floating point?
Yeah, oh, yes, we use extensive use of floating point.
Okay, so you have exactly the same problem with the floating point computations to return
the data. Yes, yeah, most of the NAND cases, we actually kill the application and restart it. For the most part, we try to keep our ranges and bounds, but yeah, it does happen. And that really is the patent, there's this last slide here, the patently unrecoverable cases. There's some things that's just nothing we can do. So anything from watchdog timeout to a floating point exception. Have systems to log the fault data for hopefully a post-mortem to figure out what we did wrong and reboot. Mentioned, RTTI is also not allowed in the coding standard, and I think the reason is probably similar to some of the issues with exceptions, although less so, is in terms of being able to predict exactly what the overhead head cost was. Yeah.
Do you find that people sometimes wind up rolling their own, if
RTTI like?
RTTI?
Yes, and I've done so. One thing is just out of hand is a lot of times you find myself wanting to use RTTI to get myself into a design box I've got myself into. What we do is we use the visitor pattern to get out of that box, and specifically I've for my own purposes kind of created an RTTI like thing using the visitor pattern where the default visit returns null and the one I want does what I need. Templates. I love templates, and they've given me so much joy and so much grief. JSF++ allows templates. I mean, it gives us high-performance code. It gives us type-safe code. But it gives us a lot of extra challenges that we just don't have with straightforward code. We can't really completely analyze the code until it's instantiated, and so I've seen more than once library developers submit the code, it compiles. Well, they compiled the header file. That's not doing me any good, And even in context, depending upon if it's not well written right, one template instantiation could be correct, but instantiating with a different type can produce wildly different behavior, of course. And so in JSF++, where we do have templates for critical code, require that every template instantiation, be exercised through a test. That's correct. Yeah.
Please repeat the question.
Oh, that in C++ you can explicitly instantiate a template, by the type you want, and that's a good way to ensure that your template compiles, and you can also use that to minimize potential code bloat.
Do you have tooling to enforce that? It seems like something would be hard to enforce.
No, we don't. I wish we did. The tooling we have is code coverage tests. So all the code, for the critical areas, the code is either covered by a test or it's not. But there's nothing, to guarantee that,
And the coverage tools distinguish between coverage of one instantiation and coverage of another?
Well, the coverage tool, that'd be at the application level. So right. So it would be at the object code. It's covering the entire object code. Lastly here, before I get to some lessons learned, so talk about MISRA C++ 2008, because it really built on what we had in JSF++, just as we built on the MISRA C. It had the advantage of about 5 years of time in between releases.
What's MISRA stand for, It
used to stand for the Motor Industry Safety and Reliability Association. There's probably people here that are smarter than me that know that. I think now it's kind of like a lot of things, they just call it MISRA, because it's used beyond the motor industry. Interesting that Toyota is was one of the charter members, But yeah, it's actually it's a good standard, but MISRA 2008 does allow exceptions and it does allow RTTI. Interestingly, in keeping with the original MISRA C rules, it still disallows all use of the free store. So people, that are required to comply with that, if they're using objects, they're either statically allocated or coming from a static pool of memory and not from the free store at all. As kind of an interesting aside, I saw that at MISRA, they require use of the macro null, whereas in JSF++, in keeping with the Bjarne Strufstrup's guidelines, it says, well, you know, null doesn't give us any type safety, so just use zero. Yeah.
You mentioned a lot about limited use of the free store, but do you also forbid recursion and limit the number of threads?
Yeah, there's a specific rule about recursion, and in, you know, the most safety critical code, we don't want to see it at all. In other code, it's allowed with the understanding that analysis has been done to limit the maximum recursion depth. You know, because we're worried about not just the time overhead as well as space overhead because our stack sizes are limited. I think if we were revisiting the coding standard, we'd probably mention the C++ null pointer keyword here on the null macro. And one other difference between MISRA and JSF++ is JSF++, you know, because it's really designed for our particular team, includes style guidelines, and MISRA C++ recognizes that every team should have their own style, and given its more general target audience, only suggests that an in-house style guide is used.
One question.
Yeah.
Cast, do you use the C style cast when you cast, or do you use static cast?
We only use static cast.
So no C style cast.
No C style cast.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you use dynamic cast?
Oh. No RTTI. We right. And even in our use of static cast, that it's we're not casting down at, you know, our, you know, inheritance hierarchies. We're using static cast for enums to ints, but not between. So it's a very, very limited casting. We try to eliminate all the casting that we can, really. But
so there would have been a standard conversion if you had assigned it to a variable, in other words.
Yeah.
Okay.
What the EM said is, how many files and lines of code are not
there roughly? Go to my last slide.
Okay.
I'm going to talk a little bit about JSF++ compliance testing and some of the challenges that we had. But the good news is you'll find, you know, thanks, that the JSF, the coding standard itself is published. There's actually several tool vendors, lint type tools. Some compilers either implement rule checks for MISRA or JSF++ or both. Again, like I said before, rules are checked automatically. Are rules that developers don't need to come to review, and I can concentrate on the hard problems. Rules checkers, even the simplest lint type tools check a lot of things that are oftentimes, you know, missed in, you know, code review and sometimes even testing, such as, you know, classic use of the equal versus equal or inadvertent semicolons, ensuring all the attributes of a class are initialized in a constructor. These are easy things for the tools to do. And the more advanced, more expensive tools can do deeper analysis for checking for nulls and overflows. And I'm not going to go into the different tool vendors. There's several out there. I suggest everybody use a static analysis tool if you don't use one now. I don't know if I found a major application that hasn't, you know, as fielded applications, you know, that a good analysis tool hasn't found something wrong with. So I think analysis is essential, relatively cheap for the potential gains, but it's no panacea like anything else. Everything that we do has got to go through a code review. And some things just aren't amenable to, automatic checking anyway. I mean, especially the style type guidelines, such as rules that say words in an ID are going to be separated by an underscore. Well, what's a word? Yeah, the tool doesn't care. Doesn't know. We talked about, you know, public and, you know, multiple inheritance. Well, that's really something in a code review. We decide when it's appropriate, when it's not appropriate. And we have rules, you know, that, you know, disparage use of multiple return statements. But then it goes on to say, but, you know, there's places for that. So, you know. You know, because a lot of times the multiple return statement simplifies the code, can eliminate potential copies, you know, defer object construction until it's really, really needed, allow the return value optimization, all that good stuff. So we allow multiple return statements, but we don't have a way for a tool to decide when it's appropriate, when it's not. So automated tools produce a few trade-offs. I mean, so, and we've gone back and forth on spinning the dial towards, you know, trying to capture more problems, but you know, sometimes risk frustrating developers with false positives or, you know, pointing out issues that really aren't operational issues versus pulling the lever back the other way so that if you find something from the tool, it's really an error, but potentially missing a lot of really questionable constructs that, you know, the tool could check otherwise. A lot of times I tend to go towards the former, that, you know, error on triggering the false positive, because a lot of times I find that even when, where the tool triggers a false positive, to me that's like a highlight. This is code I probably need to look at in the code review anyway. It's probably, if it's too tricky for the, you know, static analysis tool, it's probably, you know, too clever for its own good. So lessons learned. We've, you know, had now 10 years of JSF software development. So you know, one thing we found, especially in dealing with legacy code, is it's really more important for a common style than the details of the style itself. And so when I see legacy code, I've told people to, you know, to really concentrate on keeping the style of the code that they've inherited, as opposed to try to rework and potentially break legacy code, you know, to, you know, conform to today's or his personal, you know, style preferences. And even in the absence of exceptions, the RAI idiom, you know, it solves so many problems. I think that, you know, if we went back to the coding standard, I think we'd be very explicit about really, you know, making it something that they should just draw, you know, as just first, you know, thought without even thinking about, you know, using a raw pointer, unless they have a good reason to do so, if they're dealing with the low-level, you know, container classes and such. You know, I like, you know, dynamic, you know, static analysis tools, but, you know, there's exceptional cases that are just difficult to analyze mechanically, so we're going to, you know, be in code review, you know, always, you know, regardless of how, what I see in terms of the tool's improvements. JSF++ has some good guidelines on good template design, but, you know, dealing with five different compilers, sometimes different versions of the same compiler issued in the same years have given us different results in terms of what is valid and what is not valid in terms of template syntax. So I think we may have, you know, missed an opportunity, but we didn't know, you know, to, you know, maybe we shouldn't have. It's hard to say whether the standard should have kind of specified clearly what the common denominator, what the real template rules are, as opposed to what the compilers actually were implementing. And, you know, one thing, you know, continuing to burn us is when we go from compiler to compilers, things like dependent base class name lookup implementations, as it's like I get, but it compiled and ran on my machine, but there's five other machines I got to deal with, so. The other thing is I think it's good for the coding standard, you know, to have a rationale for every rule. I find it's a lot easier to understand the rule, enforce the rule, and for developers to use the rule if they see concrete examples and a good rationale for each one, that it's not just some old fart born in the 60s saying that this is a good thing. You know, it's good to have the rules themselves be written to, you know, enable automated compliance without ambiguities. And for example, we have a rule that's, you know, mom and apple pie. All variables shall be initialized before use. Nobody intentionally leaves their variables in a bad state. But what does that really mean, and how do we enforce that that never, ever happens? And, you know, obviously we can enforce that by requiring that local variables always are initialized at declaration. And that should be the default rule for any variable that we have. But the standard doesn't exactly say that. In MISRA, it specifically doesn't require initialization at declaration time. It simply requires that it happens before use. So, yeah, got buttons. The other thing is We don't want the standard. I like concrete examples, but the standards can also sometimes overspecify. If we say use the array class, I don't really mean use the array class. Use a container class, and hopefully you know, a vector class should be, or vector type class should be the first choice for most of the developers. But we don't want the standard to necessarily require a particular container class, just that container classes be used and not to use the native arrays. And the other thing, we have a lot of code that's generated through UML tools, through mathematical modeling tools, and then that's intermixed with our existing code base, so it creates a challenge in terms of, well, is this coding standard compliant? And you know, what we've, you know, worked hard to do is to get the code generation tools to generate code that is, to the extent possible, consistent with this style and coding standard guidelines that we have for the user-written code, because it's very problematic when dealing with a large code base of seeing code to know whether this came from a tool that we trust or whether it's a programmer that I don't trust so much. Future, you know, I think we, you know, some point, you know, embedded applications are going to be using exception handling. It definitely solves a lot of problems. It creates some challenges, but I think it would simplify, you know, a lot of code that we have if we could use it. And if, you know, if we, you know, get a chance to migrate our compilers, because the aircraft we have and the rules that we have, our tools are pretty much locked in place for now to C++ 98, but like to revisit the standard to C++ 11, which really does, like Bjarne Strefstrup said, this feels like a new language. But anyway, to answer your question, but there's currently more than 8 million lines of code. We're still writing it. I mean, but it's an evolving thing. The plane is fielded, it's flying, but there's blocks, and so we're block 3 development, and there's a block 4, and we have foreign partners that want their own customization. So I can easily see a couple more million lines of code over the next few years, you know, being added on. There's probably you know, a few hundred developers in some form or fashion involved in it. I think our use of JSF++ has proven that it's, you know, a good language for safety critical applications. You know, it gives us some expressive abstraction mechanisms. But without incurring runtime costs we could get with other languages. And I guess the proof of the pudding is we've got 100, you know, F-35s in the field right now, and they're building 2,900 more. And the coding standard is available online at jsf.mil if you want to take a look at it. And can send me any comments you have, or ask the, for the last, I guess, 5 minutes, questions that you have. Yeah?
Could you elaborate a little bit on the restrictions you put on threads?
On threads?
Yeah, on threads and communicating between processors.
Yeah. Basically, most of our threads are communicated via a double buffering scheme. This is kind of the default paradigm, where basically we have a producer and a consumer thread, where the producer will be filling out one buffer, and with a single write we'll swap a pointer so that that buffer, fully populated, then becomes available to the other thread. We try to avoid deadlocks by just keeping, you know, a few, you know, unique semaphores in the system so that we don't have ordering issues. But threading is a problem, and certainly we try to minimize the amount of code that's inside protected regions, because, you know, we have had issues with priority inversion, where one low-level thread that grabs a mutex thinks he's, because he's a low-level thread, he can just run with it. So we've, you know, has that threading does introduce some issues, but it's probably worth the good talk in itself about how to work those. Anything else? Yeah.
What kind of bugs do creep into the later stages of testing, or even into production? Like,
threading issues are the ones that probably, you know, rear themselves at the latest stages because they are, you know, so specific to the environment. Other issues that we have are data-driven issues that we can simulate, but then we fly in the real-world environment. We get, you know, inputs and combinations of inputs and ranges of inputs that we didn't expect, and we can get combinations of things, especially in transitional areas that were unpredicted by our testing. And is that good?
I've had to use signed integers all over the place for real-world calculations,
yeah.
And then when I interface with the C++ standard libraries, they love size T, unsigned. So
that's right.
Signed, unsigned is always a problem in my code. How did you guys deal with that?
Well, the JSF coding standard actually says pretty much to use signed for everything, but that's a problem. that is a problem though, because size T is a fundamental type, and I've got to use size T for compatibility with things. And so
static cast all over the place when you need.
No,
to?
Well, I static cast when I need to, you know. But I try to if I have a size T, and I'm dealing with things that are size concepts, I stay in an unsigned realm. But otherwise, I convert over. If any time I have a subtraction, I'm using a signed integer. Yeah.
So I'm confused.
Okay.
You said you don't allow heap allocation because it is supposedly non-deterministic, right?
Yeah.
But then you allow threads. Now threads actually are less predictable than memory allocation from heap. In fact, modern memory allocators on Linux in gdbc malloc and stuff are fairly deterministic. So.
Well, I think it should
be the other way around. I would disallow thread, but allow heap allocation.
Well, that's an interesting point. But the reality is we have to make compromises. And the compromises we have to make is we have multiple tasks with multiple deadlines. And some tasks have to be worked on. I mean, you know, controlling an airplane as it's moving through the air or receiving a threat, you know, if a radar picks up a missile coming at us, we want to know about that right away. So we have that running in a high priority thread. At the same time, there's low level, you know, background job type things that are processing and dealing and trying to figure solutions out. But those solutions, if they take a second, well, that's fine because they're not at the fore. So we really don't have a good alternative to using a single threaded system to accomplish all the goals that we need to accomplish.
Yeah, but we don't create threads on the fly.
No, right. Yeah. I do want to emphasize. Yeah, the threads that we have, I mean, they're pulled up. They're initialized at the startup. They're not. We don't dynamically create threads. Yeah.
Okay. So you talked a lot about logical design rules, but what about the packaging and the physical design rules? How do you render your logical designs in terms of discrete? I'm going to use the word components.
I guess I'm not sure I. Yeah.
Okay, so for example, do you have rules about, I've got a .cpp file, so
right.
Everything that's defined in the .cpp file that has external linkage is declared in the .h file?
Oh, yes.
Okay, and what size do you use to package .h, .cpp pairs, and are .h, .cpp pairs required?
Yeah, .h, .cpp pairs are required.
Okay.
And in terms of sizing, in terms of...
How many classes would you typically put in a component, a .h.cpp pair with
one.
Those properties? One, is there any exception?
I mean, not counting nested classes.
Not
but,
counting nested or private
no,
or...
No, right. In all the cases that I deal with, one class per CPP in .h.
One last question.
Sure.
Two, sorry. Do you allow cyclic dependencies among components?
Not on purpose.
So it's okay. And the last one, do you allow friendship to extend beyond the boundaries of a component?
Defining component in terms
dot
of
H,
a package.
.h.cpp pair.
Yeah,
we have one class.
We have friends, but we keep the friends within a package.
Oh, within a package. Okay. Thank you very much.
So how many F-35s did you actually physically damage or lose due to software bugs?
Zero due to software.
Yeah, due to software, yeah.
And that's all I can speak for. And I guess that got a card here that says the session's over, but I can take more after. Go ahead, sir.